Meeting is
Okay.
being recorded.
All right. So a very warm welcome to everyone. Thank you for joining us today for our training organized by the Varta Economic Inclusion Mentoring Forum. And a very big welcome to Ashish Chopra, who has very kindly agreed to spare time for a session I believe is going to be very exciting. Ashish does many things, so but primarily I think he divides his time between running BUnic, which is a very exciting e-commerce platform which enables queer entrepreneurs, artists to promote their products online. And also Ashish is part of Google India, where he is doing exactly what we are going to talk about today, CV development. So he is a recruiter as part of Google India and on a daily basis deals with CVs. So he will have a very useful insight into the topic that we have today. And I hope time will permit us. So we will also look at developing a LinkedIn profile, at least a few tips on that. And then towards the end of the session, we will also talk about how people can connect with Ashish and have a one-on-one kind of an interaction if they have further questions. So, Orkodipra, I would ask you to share any other logistics issues or technical issues. Otherwise, we hand over the reins to Ashish.
I think we're good to go, so I can change the slides as and when Ashish would want me to. But all otherwise, right. I think that's all.
All right, Ashish, so please go ahead.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks for the introduction also, Pawan. It was great. So I'm Ashish, as Pawan already mentioned everything about me. I don't know what more to add. I recently joined Google. It's just been a month. And but I have been working for Amazon and Wipro and Philips before this. And everywhere my job was recruitment. So I would go through 100 resumes every day, shortlist 10, 15 of them, have a word with all these candidates and check who is better, who would be a good fit. So that is what my career is. I hire people. So from my 5-6 years of experience into this, I will be just sharing my experience. A lot of people might tell you other things also, and it's totally up to you. I'm just sharing my experience, what I would notice in a resume or in a LinkedIn profile, because I mostly hire from LinkedIn or if people directly apply on the Google Ka Careers website. So these are the two main channels I am hired from. So I would tell you, I look at a resume, I look at a LinkedIn profile. There are other ways also of finding a job, but I would focus on a CV because the CV you can use for any other sources, and LinkedIn profile because we source candidates from LinkedIn. We have to go on LinkedIn, find candidates who work with the following skills and move on. Can you move to the next slide, Okudipu? So this is all what we'll be covering today. We'll cover what a resume format should be like, what to write in a resume, what not to write in a resume, because there are a lot of times people write very irrelevant stuff on a resume. So I will quickly give you a small brief as to what should be mentioned and what should not be mentioned. We will tell you what a LinkedIn profile should look like. At least have a very simple, very basic in LinkedIn profile. We don't want anything super fancy where you are using very exotic words to excite the recruiter. We will keep it very simple as it can get. And we will cover interviews as well. Like the first bit I'll cover is how to get an interview at an organization. What is the best way to get your resume noticed by an organization? A bit of that. And interviews way, like how to present yourself, how to talk about yourself, a few tips on that. Next slide, please. So first is resume. If you're making a resume, we will send this link to you. We'll send the whole presentation to you, in fact. Canva is this beautiful website where you can make a resume for free. So just click on this link and it will take you to this page. It'll give you a 5 to 10 formats of resumes. You can scroll down here. These are just two samples. You will find resumes like this on Canva, and all you have to do is replace your name with that name, your experience with that experience, your education with that education. You just have to replace that stuff. So this is a sample that's already there on the website. And you can just put your details here by replacing their details. And now we go down, next slide please. So what all should you write on your resume? The first thing, definitely never miss out on this. In 2022, I still can't believe people are sending resumes without their phone number, without their email ID. It is just unacceptable. Please always have your name, phone number, email ID for sure on your resume. It is incomplete if your resume does not have these three items. So please never forget, these simple basics have to be there. A picture is always great. If you're not comfortable, it's absolutely fine. But a picture just adds more authenticity to the resume, I would say. It just makes me connect to the candidate also, that, oh, I can see what the candidate is like. So a picture is great. If you're not comfortable, it's totally fine. And the designation, like suppose I'm making my own resume, I'll put my picture, I'll write Ashish Chopra, this is my phone number, email ID, my address, and my designation, I work as a recruiter at Google. So please mention what work are you currently doing. These are just the personal details, that'll be just the top of the resume. Then we'll get into the work experience. Initially, I would suggest have like a two-line introduction ready. Suppose, for example, I'll give my example again. I'm Ashish, I work as a recruiter, and I have been working as a recruiter for the last 6 years with the following organizations. My job includes shortlisting resumes, finding candidates on LinkedIn. Just try to explain what you do in two lines. That is just a basic introduction. Then we get into the organization-wise experience. So first would be name of the organization. Like right now, I'll mention Google. Duration is how long have I been working there and what all are my duties. So I'll write Google. I've been working there for the last 2 months now. And my duties are finding resumes on LinkedIn, finding resumes on the career portal who all have applied, having a conversation with the candidates, screening them, deciding their salaries, what level would they fit on. These are all my duties, which I will mention. So just keep it very simple in 3 or 4 lines maximum. Try to explain what you do in your job. And keep it very simple. Don't use very fancy words. Don't use very heavy words. Because of what I am doing, if I am looking for a Java developer, say for say, I will only look for Java developers. I will not look for like expert in Java, or I will not look for, I will only search for a Java developer. So it's very important that you have just the simple Java developer words in your resume. I always mention your highlights, awards, certifications that you have gotten at work. If you've done something exceptional, if you've gotten an award or a recognition at work for amazing performance, do mention that as well. That's a huge plus. If you have worked with multiple organizations, so write an introduction, write the company's name, duration, your duties, and the award that you won in just 3 to 4 lines. All of this has to be 3 to 4 lines only. Then after you've mentioned your personal details at the top, your work experience as the main body of the resume, you can also write a lot of, we call it the fillers. It can be your education history. Education is also super important. You can mention the highest education that you have. If it's 10th standard, if it's 12th standard, just mention that this was your score in the following year where you did this particular course. Please mention what skills you are good with. If you're good with hiring, if you're good with coding, if you're good with teaching, mention what are your core skills in just one word. You can put like a hashtag. You'll see in the resume format up there that your skills are teaching, English language, communication, Microsoft Excel, whatever you're good at, just make hashtags of it and put it in a small corner. You can also mention languages if you're really good with languages. If you can take up translation professionally, please mention that you're extremely fluent with these following languages. I would avoid mentioning languages that you have basic level understanding of. So if you're writing about languages, only write about those languages in which you can, like you're an expert in those languages. For me, it is only Hindi and English. So I write Hindi and English expert in my resume. I don't mention that I speak a little bit of Bengali. I do not write that. So Amar Bangla Bhalo Na. So do not mention languages that you're still learning, or at least if you can have a decent conversation in it and you are comfortable with it, you can, that you have learned enough that you can have a decent conversation. So that is just a very basic format of what all should a resume have: your personal details, your work, and the fillers, education, and skills and languages. Can we go to the next slide? And if you have any questions, please unmute yourself and ask right now. You can stop me whenever. It's absolutely fine. So don't feel uncomfortable. We will take a pause if you have any questions, if you want to ask anything about your experience, that I work as a teacher, what all should I write? I work as a makeup artist, what should I write on my resume? So just feel free to stop me and ask whatever you want to.
So Ashish, I had one question.
Yeah.
So a lot of people who come to our forum under skills, they're sometimes really confused in terms of what they should write. So while some people write basic computer skills, some people write MS Office. So a lot of them would possibly not have very advanced skills like coding or translation. Mm-hmm. So how do you think we should help them maybe translate their skills into something that would like employable skills rather?
Yeah.
So would you say, right, like explaining more about, okay, under MS Office, I am proficient in MS Word, etc. So how should we probably go about that?
So you can have something very simple like communication skills also as a skill that you're good at communicating. You can write email writing, you can write typing. Even those are skills. If you don't have like expertise in coding, if you're not expertise in other stuff, you can mention very basic things like these also. These are also very valid skills. And skills are mostly related to the kind of job that you're also looking for. If you are good at typing, if you could be a receptionist, if you're good at anything else, it has. But the skills have to be at least a bit relevant to what you're looking for. It can be communication skills. A receptionist would need good communication skills. Email writing is something very important. Email writing can be a skill. MS Word, MS Excel are very important skills as well. I really need people who are very good with Excel. So that is also a very important skill. And even if you know just the basics of that, that's absolutely fine. You don't need to know like advanced level of Excel to mention it in your skills section.
Right. And would you also suggest writing things like leadership abilities?
Definitely, definitely. What I would say that you should not write is that you won a chess competition in fifth standard, or you won a badminton something in seventh standard. Anything before 10th standard might not be very relevant. So anything you've done after your 10th standard, after, if you've studied more, you can write more. If you've had work experiences, you can write more of that. But try and keep it very relevant. Try and keep it very latest. Try and keep all the latest stuff on top. And what if you don't have a lot to write on your resume, then probably you can mention these co-curricular activities that you won any other awards for all of that. So, but keep it to the lower end then.
Right. Okay. And one last thing, sorry. If it's, for example, they're writing about their interest in sports, would you suggest like mentioning what sports they're good at and writing their achievements under it?
For sure. I forgot to write that down. We obviously have a section for hobbies as well. Because what nowadays, especially when I am looking, say, for a Java developer, I'll just take a very simple example of probably a receptionist. If I want a receptionist, I want someone who's good at email writing, I want someone who's good at communication. But I also want to know what more does the receptionist bring to the table, because I can find 100 other people who can do the same thing. But if I find a receptionist who is like adventurous and likes mountain climbing and stuff like that, that makes me more interested in that candidate. So try and make your resume more exciting about telling as much as you can in lesser words. I would definitely suggest a resume should not be more than one page. I have about 6 years of experience. Even then, my resume is only one page. So one page resumes are the best, because I have to go through at least 100 resumes every day. I don't have a lot of time to go through 2-3 pages of your experience. I would prefer one page, everything short, concise, exactly to the point. I don't want long stories where you mentioned your entire experience, that you, the whole project that you worked on. I don't want all details. I want just the basics in one or two lines. That's all. So one page is just something I would suggest people should stick. If you have more than 10 years of experience, then you can probably go for the second page. But 3 pages is just no.
So Ashish, another question. Mm-hmm. There are for a number of our aspirants, many of them don't have much work experience. Mm-hmm. They are either still studying or who have just about a year or two in terms of work experience. In that case, is there any difference in the order of presenting the information, or should the flow be the same?
The flow should be similar. Should the flow is, this is what is a standard. Your personal details come first, your work experience, and then education and your hobbies and languages and skills. So the format should be the same. But if you have only one year or 2 year of experience at only one organization, then you can probably write a lot more on what all your responsibilities are. You can write every small detail about your job in that case, because you have right. You have to fill that one page up. If I don't like to see a lot of blank spaces in a one page resume, so try and fill it up as much as you can, and try and write down as much as you can about the job that you're doing.
Okay, right.
Yeah.
Sure. Thanks.
Can I ask you something?
Sure. Go ahead.
Would you be comfortable in telling me how you became a recruiter?
How I became a recruiter?
Yes. That's what I asked.
Okay. So I studied bachelor's in business administration, BBA, in human resources. Then I did an MBA in human resources, both from Symbiosis Pune. And I was hired from campus first at Wipro. Then I moved to Philips. Then I moved to Amazon. And now I work at Google.
Thank you. That's inspirational. I ask this because I am doing my psychology degree. I'm in my third year.
Okay.
And I'm still confused about things. And that's why I wanted to know. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. No problem. If you need any advice, I'm always there. I'll share my contact details also towards the end. So please feel free to reach out whenever you want to. If you need any kind of advice later, I'm always available. I'm just one message away all the time. So no worries, okay? Don't worry, I'm here. I will try my best to help you as much as I can. I cannot promise that I'll get you a job, but I will try my best. Can we go to the next slide, Oppo? So LinkedIn profile is super important. If you are actively looking for a job, I don't know, people still don't have a LinkedIn profile and they say they're looking for a job. I don't think they're serious. You cannot be looking for a job and not have a LinkedIn profile. It is mandatory to have a LinkedIn profile. All organizations are using LinkedIn for hiring. You have to be there. If you haven't made an account yet, it's never too late to start. Open an account today. That is mandatory. We also go through, the first thing we receive a resume, we go through is their LinkedIn profile. So please open a LinkedIn profile right now, not right now, after the session. Open a LinkedIn profile as soon as you can. We'll quickly go through what all should a LinkedIn profile contain. Here also, I would definitely suggest add a picture. If your LinkedIn profile does not have a picture, a lot of times it feels like it's a fake profile. It is not very real. So it adds a lot more realness. A picture is super important, at least on a LinkedIn profile. If not on your resume, if you're not comfortable putting in your resume, I would advise that you at least have a picture here. It just gives more realness to it. Again, career details, you have to mention all the organizations that you've worked with, the duration from what month to what year to whenever you were working, and what all were your responsibilities, very similar to the resume. Education history also, what all have you studied, from which college, from what year to what year, very similar to the resume, keep it as it is. And the skills and endorsement section here on a LinkedIn profile is a section where you can mention what all are your skills. Suppose in my profile, I write, I'm good with MS Excel, I'm good with recruiting, I'm good with sourcing candidates, I'm good with resume writing. These are my skills. What an endorsement is, when Pawan sir will endorse my skill and say that, oh, I've worked with Ashish and I think he's good with CV writing. So my CV writing will show plus one that, okay, other people are recommending that Ashish is good with CV writing. If Orko Deepra also says that I'm good with CV writing, it will make a plus two. So more people who promote your skill, it gives more genuineness that, okay, a lot of people are saying this person is good at this skill. So they are probably good at that skill, unless you've just asked your friends to do it. But a lot of people do that also. You can ask a lot of your friends that, hey, if you can just quickly endorse some of my skills, that'll be great. So try and mention all your skills there. And the most important skills should have some endorsements. Even like if we have not worked very close, I'd be happy to like just add a plus one. It's just one click of a button. So it's not that difficult to do an endorsement. You just have to click on a plus one, that's all. So that's just about the personal details. The second is companies. Please follow all the companies that you're targeting to work for. If you want a job at Google, follow Google's page also. If you want to follow all the big tech companies, follow all the startups that you might be interested in, follow every organization that you would consider as a workplace. And you would want to follow and keep up with what the organization is doing. So connect with, follow all their pages. Also, suppose I am in HR. I would follow other HR professionals who are at bigger organizations, who are at senior positions. So follow these industry leaders. It's great to know their insights. It's all, sometimes you never know, they might just notice you as well. So if suppose the HR manager of Facebook makes a post about recruitment and what are the trends, I might just comment and say, oh, I totally agree. But there's one point I would like to have a debate. I don't disagree with what you are saying. You can have a conversation with that candidate, with that leader, and that can get you noticed. That can actually get you hired as well. So try and follow these industry leaders. Try and see what they're writing about and try and get their attention. You have to get their attention. It can just land you a job as well. So follow the companies you want to work with and target. Follow the leaders of that organization or follow the leaders in your industry who you think are relevant leaders in that industry. And follow target companies I've mentioned. Connect with the HRs of the target companies. Yeah, suppose if you want a job at Zomato, all you have to do is in the search bar at LinkedIn, just write Zomato recruiter, and it will send you a list of recruiters who work at Zomato. It is that easy to find who works at Zomato as a recruiter and just connect with them. Just tell them that, hey, I saw this job opening at Zomato and I think I could be a good fit. Would you think you could just refer my resume? Do you think we can have a quick interview? Feel free to reach out to them. That is just a very informal way of doing it. We can also apply. We'll get on the interview process later. But so this is what your profile should be. Have all the details. What all should you do? What all companies and connections to follow? And what exactly should you be doing on LinkedIn? Make relevant comments on posts by people. As I mentioned, if there is an industry leader, if there's a Java coding expert, and he just posts a code, and if you find a mistake, you will get a job. That, oh, he's a Java leader and you found a mistake in his code, you're obviously pretty good at your work then. So do try and engage with these leaders of their own fields. Also, LinkedIn has a section for jobs. So keep checking if you find relevant jobs. And all the organizations in India will post their job on LinkedIn. Almost all, I'm not saying everyone does, but most of the leading organizations now are posting their jobs only on LinkedIn. So keep a lookout on the job section. You can actually mention if you're looking for a psychologist, if you're looking for a job as a psychologist, it will keep showing you that these organizations, these hospitals are looking for psychologists, and you can directly apply. Follow more LGBTQ people, at least in India. I would totally suggest that we are a small community. Please follow as many LGBTQ professionals as you can. There's Suresh Ramdas from HP. I will give you a list of all the LGBTQ people you should follow, because I would definitely like to see more LGBTQ people in my organization. And so it's the same case with every other queer person. We want more representation. We want more queer people to join in our organizations. So just connect with them and mention that, hey, and don't just say that, hey, I am gay and I want to join your organization. What you can probably mention is, I just wanted to know what your workplace is like. Is it safe for queer people like me? Keep it subtle, make it subtle, but put your point forward that you are queer and you are looking for a safe space to work with. Also share your experiences, that how has job hunting as a queer person been for you? That also gets attention from a lot of people who are actively looking to hire people from the LGBT community. You can mention all the challenges you have faced, any discrimination that you have faced. You can write a huge LinkedIn post about it, that I was interviewing with an organization and I did not feel comfortable. They were using the wrong pronouns, I clearly mentioned. Even then, they were not okay. You can talk about it. Don't name the organizations. I don't know why I have been told to not talk in a negative manner for any other organization. So if you want to share an experience, you can share the whole experience without naming the organization. That is a very safe thing to do. You can name the organization if you're really against what happened and you want to do something very serious about it. But to keep it safe, it's considered very safe to not name the organization and share your entire experience. And this gets a lot of attention from other recruiters, because even me right now, I have to hire as many queer people, as many women as I can into Google. So I am looking for what women are posting. I'm looking for what queer people are posting on LinkedIn, just to know that, okay, we can look at this person to hire them. Questions, please go ahead. Any questions, anything related to LinkedIn, what to write, what not to write?
What can a student write?
Whatever you're learning, especially that. So suppose you're about to finish college and you can mention that, oh, it's in COVID times, it's so scary. A lot of people are not getting jobs. As a queer person, I'm not even sure my college might not give me a placement. And just mention also about what you're studying psychology, you said, right?
Yes, I do.
Yeah. So, like, your degree, what was it all about? What all were your major learnings from it? And just stuff related to psychology.
Okay. So, would a LinkedIn profile help me in any way to get to land me a master's seat anywhere?
So, colleges work very differently. They will only check your work. They will only check your skills that you are actually good with. It is only these organizations who are hiring candidates. They do like all this background research of their LinkedIn profile. I don't think colleges would read what you are posting on LinkedIn. So colleges, they only would like to see your merits, your certifications. Try and get as many certifications as you can. LinkedIn itself has a lot of courses. So once you log in to LinkedIn, you will see a lot of courses. You can do some free courses as well related to psychology. That also comes under your certifications. There's a separate section for certifications on LinkedIn. So it will keep adding up. The more certifications you have, more better it is. And if I'm looking for a psychologist, if you have like 10 certifications, if you have relevant experience all related to psychology, your profile will be the first one that pops up to me. It will show me that this person could be the most relevant because all his certifications are in psychology, all his work experience has been in psychology. So try and do as many certifications as you can, even not just on LinkedIn, even from outside as well. Even small organizations doing small certification courses, that also work.
I'll check that out. Thank you.
Yeah, it doesn't have to be a Harvard certification or a Yale certification. A small organization in Delhi or Kolkata doing a small certificate course also gives some credit that, okay, this person has actually done some research, done some studying in that sector. So do as many certifications as you can. Next slide, please.
Ashish, I had one question. So regarding work experiences on our LinkedIn profile, would you suggest describing it in a similar way as we do on our CVs, or is there something, or should the wording be comparatively like different?
Some people keep it exactly the same. That is absolutely fine. But on a LinkedIn profile, it can be very lengthy. So you can, here there's no limit. You can write as much as you want on a LinkedIn profile. And but the main thing is it has to have the most important keywords. What I am looking for is if I'm looking for a Java C++ developer, if that person has mentioned Java again and again on his resume, I know he'll be pretty good. If he has mentioned C++ again and again and again, so try and mention what your skills are in every second or third line. My experience, if I write on my LinkedIn profile, hiring candidates, sourcing through LinkedIn, interviewing candidates, so try and use these important keywords related to your industry as much as you can. The more you use it, the more are the chances of you getting noticed, more are the chances that your profile will pop up before other people's profiles.
All right.
So if I'm looking for a Java developer who has worked with C++ also, if you have mentioned Java and C++ 50 times in your LinkedIn profile and someone who has mentioned it 20 times, your profile will come up first. But that does not mean that you just randomly keep writing Java C++ everywhere to make your resume pop up. It has to form a complete sentence. It has to make sense. So try and use the keywords that you're working on as many times as you can on the LinkedIn profile. That will really pop your LinkedIn profile up the search.
All right. That's helpful. Thank you.
This is the most important bit, how to get notice, how to get an interview call from your organization that you really want to work with. And people struggle. I have been fighting to get this job, and I only know how barely I managed to get this job. It is very difficult, especially to get noticed by big organizations. It is much easier with startups. It's much easier with small organizations. But if you want to get noticed by a bigger organization that has like 1 lakh employees, it is very difficult to get your resume noticed, to get through. So here are just a few tips. Can you scroll down, please? So the most important thing every organization does, if they have a job opening, if I am looking for a data scientist, for example, I post the job on LinkedIn, I post the job on my internal portal. The first thing recruiters look for is how many employees have referred their data scientist friends. So the first most important thing is to get an employee referral. If you know someone, so now you know me and Google. If I say that, okay, I know Shreyas, who's a good psychologist, and there's a psychologist, a job that is available at Google, your resume will easily get noticed. So try and get an employee referral. If you know someone at that organization who can refer you, that'll be great. This is also when I told you about messaging HRs of that company. If you're looking for a job at Zomato, look for a recruiter at Zomato and try and message them that, hey, I saw this opening of a data scientist at Zomato. I think I have relevant experience. Here is my resume. Would you please would you be okay referring me for the following position? So employee referrals are the most important section to get a job, I would say. If you know people in a particular organization that you want to work at, ask them to get you a referral. That is really the best way to get your resume noticed. Second is job boards. You can apply for jobs on LinkedIn. You can apply for jobs on Naukri. There's Indeed. Try and throw your resume to as many jobs. You can randomly apply, but keep it very relevant. It's not that, okay, there are 100 job openings at Google and you apply to all 100 of them. The worst part, that's what I can see, that if a candidate has applied 50 times, I can see that this candidate who I'm about to talk to has applied 50 times for these following jobs. So if you're applying, don't just randomly apply to jobs. Keep it very relevant. If you are a psychologist with 3 years of experience, apply to jobs at that level. Don't apply for a psychology director level 20 years of experience when you have only 3 years of experience. So keep it very relevant when you're applying for these jobs. Please upload your profiles on Naukri. A lot of companies hire from Naukri, Indeed, Monster, these three job boards. And it's free, so there's no cost. If once you make your resume through Canva, just upload it on these three portals, you might just start getting calls from organizations. And they might not be big organizations, but it's a start. There's no harm in starting with like a smaller organization. As long as you're doing good work, you're working well, and you work anywhere, it's okay. So upload your profile on LinkedIn, Naukri, Monster, and Indeed, these three job portals. LinkedIn, pay, keep applying to relevant job openings. Also, if you're on LinkedIn, you might see that Zomato is hiring. Also go on Zomato's website, Zomato's career page, and apply there again. That also increases your chances of getting noticed again and again. That they will see that, okay, I've seen this resume again, let's go through it again. So try and make sure that your resume is getting through. Also reach out, as I mentioned, if employee referrals and job boards applying everywhere does not work out, then reach out to the recruiters and say that, hey, I've already applied. I haven't received a response yet. Can you please check? That's just an easy way to find out what is happening at the organization. Are they considering your profile? Will they be moving forward? You can ask them for feedback also. Sometimes you might not get a response. Don't feel sad. Move on to the other organization, move on to another job. Sometimes, because I get about 100 messages, it's impossible to reply to each and every message. So just keep trying is what I'll say. There will be a day you will get noticed for sure. Employee referrals are the best, as I mentioned. Try and get a referral into an organization. Keep applying to jobs on all the portals. Keep your profile updated on Naukri, Monster, Indeed, and apply on the job portal as well. Apply on the company's job website as well. and then reach out to the recruiter. Any questions?
So Ashish, of course, I mean, people can have, I just want to just let the participants know that if you still have a question on the CV or the LinkedIn profile, you can ask anytime, or you can even send a message to the chat box.
Yes, please.
Yeah, but I have a question which is more to do with after one has got an interview call. So can one discuss that?
Sure. Go ahead.
This is again based on the general profile of the aspirants. A number of them would have concerns around the HR policies of an organization. Maybe it is to do with the benefits that they are talking about for LGBT people, or the confidentiality policy that they have for their employees, and or otherwise any other incentives that are there, which are supposed to be there for people from certain marginalized backgrounds. So how does one bring up this issue in an interview? At what stage should one talk about it?
Okay. So after you have applied, after you have gotten an employee referral, there will be one call by a recruiter. So like, suppose me, I will give you a call and I will ask you about your experience to decide if we should send you forward to the next round of interviews or not. So once you get a call from a recruiter, I would suggest that you have a pitch ready for yourself, a 3 to 5 minute introduction about yourself, about your education, the work that you have done, have the highlights. Mention that, okay, I made sure that at this organization, these are the following things I changed, and this was the impact, this was the result. Try and have like a 3 to 5 minute introduction ready, that this is all what I did, these are my achievements, this is how I changed that organization. Just the highlights, what made you stand out. So keep a 5 minute introduction, because the first question that we do ask candidates, I know it's very cliched, is, please, can you introduce yourself? Tell me about yourself. So that is when you have 5 minutes to impress the recruiter. Once you do your introduction, that is when we go in depth. That is when you're like, okay, in your first organization, you said you worked on this. Have all data ready is what I'll say. When I was interviewing, I had like a sticky note right on my laptop, which mentioned that, okay, at Wipro, I did this. At Philips, I did these many hires, and I exceptionally performed well. I did 30 hires in a quarter. That was like a big target for us, which we could never achieve, but I achieved that. So have the highlights ready, that what made you stand out? Why should we hire you? What impact did you make at your previous organizations to make sure that you can impress me? You have to just impress the recruiter. As long as you can do that, you will keep going through the other rounds of interviews as well. So keep mentioning what are your highlights, what made you stand out. If there are 1,000 Java developers out there, what makes you different? You have to give us that. And it can be something as being queer as well, because you are bringing a totally different perspective. There can be 999 straight Java developers doing probably the same thing, but that one queer Java developer might just bring in a whole different perspective. So you have to mention what makes you stand out. Why are you better than the other candidates who apply for the same job? So at the first round of interview, keep it very simple. Keep it about yourself, all about your experience. If you clear that, that is when the technical interviews start. That will also be very, that is when the rigorous interview process begins. Some of them might have just one or two rounds. A lot of companies now have started having 4 to 5 rounds for this. And it can be a little hectic. So try and ask them for some time after every interview. When I was interviewing at one of the other organizations, I had 4 rounds of interviews back to back. And I realized I was so exhausted after the 4th round. I don't think I did well also, which is probably why I was rejected. So please ask them for time. It's absolutely okay to say, can we have one interview in a day? And most of the times they will agree. Unless they are in like a hurry and we really want to close the position as soon as possible. in those cases, they might ask you to squeeze in as much as you can. But it's absolutely okay to ask for more time, to say that I want to prepare well for the next round. So ask for some time, take your own time to prepare yourself for the interview. There might be 2 to 3 rounds of technical interviews. In those technical interviews, it would be okay to ask the panelists that, hey, I do identify as a queer individual. What is the level of awareness of people in your organization? Does everyone know what LGBTQ stands for? Are they aware? Is your organization LGBTQ friendly? After you complete the first round of the recruiter screen, the second round onwards, you can ask these questions that, do you have any policies? Do you have gender neutral washrooms? That is after the first round is when I would say you can ask the following questions.
Right. Yeah, because I think it's a sort of, one has to strategize a bit in an interview also. And it's about both finding out and presenting yourself.
Yeah, even in the first round, even in the recruiter round, I would suggest that you can mention it. Because if suddenly someone says that I do identify as queer, and Google is really looking for more queer people to come on board. So I would definitely focus more on that candidate and be like, okay, he's a queer person who is a Java developer and can be just better than all the other Java developers. So just, you can mention it for sure. Go ahead.
Right.
Do we have any more questions about the interview process? What not to say at an interview? Please don't say negative things about the organization. Please do your research about the organization that you're applying at also. You need to know what the organization does. Also, like, try and go through the job description that, okay, this is the job I'm applying for. These are my responsibilities that might be. And ask questions. Ask a lot of questions. That really is a lot of candidates who I interview don't ask me any questions. And I just feel a little bit sad that, okay, you are interviewing at Google and you don't have any questions. So I want someone who has done their research about the organization, about the job. And I want them to be very specific about, okay, what exactly do you think my job would be like? I want them to ask me, what are the good things about working at Google? What is something I don't like about Google also? Feel free to ask all of this. Ask a lot of questions to the recruiter also. An interview is not just a one-way process where the interviewer is interviewing you. You are also checking the organization, how well would you fit in into that organization. So ask a lot of questions. That really helps. That really is, and it shows that you have also done some research and are actually very serious about it. I think the next slide has my contact details. You can please share that with everyone. Please feel free to reach out to me on Instagram, on Facebook, on my phone number, on my email ID. I can mention my phone number also in the chat box if anyone wants that. And yeah, there's Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn. Yeah. You can write to me on LinkedIn also. I'm pretty active on LinkedIn because it's my job to be there every day. 27279. That's all. Are there any more questions? Anyone wants to know anything else?
Maybe it's a good idea if we... Yeah, sorry.
No, go ahead.
I thought somebody else was going to ask something. Maybe it's a good idea to just show the resume formats once again, if people have anything in particular to ask.
Yeah. And if you have a lot of experience and you can't write your resume on your own, there are some resume writers available. They might charge a lot, but I would definitely suggest that you do it on your own or ask for some help. I mean, we are all here to help you as well. So if you want us to write a few sentences on your work experience, we can definitely help you with that as well.
Yes, I think that is why the forum is there. And also, unless, you know, the CV is a very personal thing, you can't have someone else writing it for you.
Exactly.
But maybe, I mean, we encourage people to come up with anything that they can. And then the idea is to help them fine tune it. So
even after my college, I had no idea what to write in my resume. So I asked a lot of people, then, hey, what are you writing? And like a queer person only was a friend of mine. He wrote my entire resume for me, for which I was very thankful. But I would definitely suggest don't do that. That was very lazy of me also, I would say. Please try as much as you can, at least your personal details and your education and your skills and your hobbies are something you can easily write. If you want help with the work experience bit, that we can definitely help you with.
Ashish, I had a few questions.
Go ahead.
So, for example, we spoke about the introduction, and that's one part that a lot of the aspirants who come to the forum struggle with, because they mostly can't figure out whether they should talk about what they are looking for in the job that they are looking for, or whether they should write about their past experiences and the skills that they have. So how do you suggest they should go about it?
That is super confusing, because there are times when what you have done might be very slightly related to the job you're applying for. It can be difficult to connect those two, that you have worked with the following, but you want to apply for something like this. It can be a little tricky, but I would suggest try and connect it to what you're applying for. Try and make sure that they notice that, okay, I'm looking for this, this, this. And even if you have worked with either one or two of those, out of the four things that they're looking for, try and talk about those one or two things as much as you can. Try and expand it in as much as you can. You have to make sure that you are giving the company what they are asking for.
Right.
So some people have separate resumes for different jobs they're applying for. That's also absolutely fine. Suppose if you're into art, especially art direction and all, I just wanted on the sample resume. A lot of people might make separate resumes for, they can be performing arts, they can be like all different sorts of arts. They have separate resumes for it. So if I'm applying for a job at other organizations also, they make organization-wise separate resumes. That is also, a lot of people do that, but I don't think that's required at this level. That'd be very relevant. That's when you can do that. Initial levels, I think that just one resume is fine.
All right. And do you suggest also, for example, writing in the last line about what kind of jobs you are looking for and what exactly you're looking for in that particular job?
Not in a resume. I don't think I would write that in a resume. You can mention that on a call when you're talking to the recruiter, but don't write what you're looking for. Or when you're writing about me, like a small introduction on the top, you can mention that I'm looking for an opportunity to grow and to learn as much as I can in the field of whatever field you're working in. That is something you can write, but it has to be about you.
Right. So not something like I want to work, for example, in the administrative sector of this kind of job.
You can write that in the about me section, yes.
All right. And how important would you say are references in a resume?
They're not important at all. No one is checking references these days. I mean, 10, 20 years back, it was a super important part of the resume. But now, not anymore. Especially when on a LinkedIn profile, you have a lot of endorsements. If you can ask your previous managers to write a recommendation is also super helpful. So all the people you have worked with, it can be from a colleague, it can be from your ex-manager. Ask them to write a recommendation for you on your LinkedIn profile. That is also super helpful. But references on a resume, at least no one's looking for them. No one will reach out. If you clear the 3-4 rounds of interviews, that is when a lot of people ask that, hey, we would like to talk to one of your previous managers. Can you share their phone number, their contact details? That is when they might ask, but nowadays they don't even do that. So it's absolutely fine to not write about references.
All right. Thank you.
Anything else?
So since LinkedIn is also kind of part of social media in a way, so are there any tips that you would share? Because I think a lot of people use different kinds of media, but very often people are not careful about what they're posting. So, you know, some do's and don'ts.
LinkedIn, do not post about your personal stuff, about your personal pictures that you went on a vacation. Never post anything political as well when you're criticizing the government there. And you can do that on Facebook, Instagram, everywhere else. But on LinkedIn, it's all professional. Keep it very work related. As long as it relates to the work, it relates to organization, to your work experience, you can talk about it. But no irrelevant posts about like your personal life. Anything that relates to work, that relates to a job, that relates to an organization, you can talk about that. No personal posts on LinkedIn, please. No political discussions. I have seen people talking about how horrible Narendra Modi is, and LinkedIn is not the platform for it. Most of the comments you see on the comment post of that post would be, this is not the platform, you should not be raising such topics here. So please avoid political discussions, definitely avoid on LinkedIn.
But one can critique a policy or a program.
Definitely. Definitely feel free to talk about, and especially if you are into like the government policies and all of that, and you're just criticizing and you're just studying, going through the policy, that's absolutely fine. But if I'm an HR professional and I'm talking about an HR policy, it all makes sense. If I'm talking about, say, the GDP of the country, that is not very relevant. So I would still prefer that I talk about sexual harassment policies, I talk about recruitment policies. So it has to be relevant to your work or to what you're studying, but not like, not about the country, not about a person.
Right.
No platform is safe for criticizing him, definitely.
And this is getting recorded.
Great. Any more questions?
I think this would be a very specific question, but for example, a lot of people, be it research positions or maybe for newspaper or journalist position, these would more or less require something on the lines of submitting a writing sample. So would you suggest maybe attaching a link to your resume that would direct you to a folder with your writing samples?
Definitely. A lot of content writers do that. A lot of graphic designers attach their portfolio. Please feel free to attach these documents, attach a link of all the work that you have done. That is really helpful.
All right.
I don't know why did I miss that, but yes, please, that is super important. If your work relates to showing people, like makeup artists, how will they show makeup on their resume? You have to attach pictures, you probably attach your Instagram profile there. If you're a content writer, you cannot just write all your content on your resume. So you attach, probably you have just one link where you can have sublinks of all the work that you've done. That really helps.
Great.
And should the LinkedIn profile be mentioned on the CV? The link?
Yes. Yeah, a lot of people do mention their LinkedIn profile also. It is a good practice. Please feel free to attach your LinkedIn profile ka link or the URL up there.
Right.
My God, now I'm realizing I missed out on a lot of things. Thank you so much for this.
Yeah, the more we discuss an issue, more points come up.
Yeah.
This is the second time I'm doing this session, and now I've realized I've missed out on a lot of things. How diplomatically mention in LinkedIn about any harassment incidents on workplace? That is a tricky question. I would suggest that you do share your experience. If you have gone through something that wasn't right, please feel free to talk about your experience. That way, I was working at an organization, one of my previous organizations. Again, don't name the organization. It's advised that you do not name the organization and mention that what all happened. It's absolutely fine to share your experience. If you have gone through a negative experience, please mention Like even in my first organization, I went through a lot. It was horrible, but I've still not made like a horrible post about them that, oh, this IT company is so disgusting. I would totally say that no one should ever go there. It's considered unprofessional. So I would not make that post, but I can, but I did mention once that there was a time in my, one of my previous organizations, I did go through horrible times. I did go through harassment at work. So it's absolutely safe to say that you have faced a lot of stuff in your previous organization, but keep it, don't name the organization. I know it's horrible. I definitely don't want any of my friends to work for that particular organization where I was, where I went through all that torture. And I would like to make a post about it that that place is not a safe place to work at, but not on LinkedIn. It's not considered professional on LinkedIn. You can criticize an organization on other platforms. Cool then. Is that all? I hope we've covered. I mean, readers of the incident can figure this out by looking at had the work experience, as you mentioned in the company. Again, readers are smart that way then. At least you did not name the organization, so you are safe. I have mentioned that I was working at an organization. I was working at four different organizations. If you can figure out which one it was, perfect. But at least you have not directly mentioned the name of the organization, so you are okay. So that is what I would suggest, that don't directly name organizations. You can share that you had a horrible experience somewhere, but don't name them. If you have only worked for one organization and you're making that post, it might be a little scary because then everyone would know what organization it is. But just try and stay away from naming a particular organization.
Ashish, I have... Sorry, Pavan sir, were you going to ask something?
No, go ahead.
I've just been going through our previous aspirants, the mentoring forum data. So I've been coming up with questions because of that. Okay. So one more thing. So a lot of them have undergone few training programs or certificate courses. So where do you suggest mm-hmm. they should put those down?
Both in your resume and your LinkedIn profile. Certifications are super important. Next to education. As close to education as it can be, because it gives you a lot of backing that, okay, you have studied this particular section, you have actually done the certification. It can be from a small organization, as I said, it can be any kind of certification, but and try and do as many certifications as you can in your field, in your industry. LinkedIn itself has a lot of courses you can, and LinkedIn will directly put a certification in your profile once you complete a LinkedIn course. So feel free to do that. And you can mention that in your resume as well. Mm-hmm. So try and do as many. LinkedIn has some assessments also. If I do a C++ course, it will do an assessment and it will tell all the recruiters that this person has completed the C++ assessment. So he's good at it. So if you're into one of those technical skills, if you're into any of these particular skills that can be checked by LinkedIn, you should do that assessment also. That's also free of cost. So please do all these assessments, all these certifications as much as you can.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So, Ashish, since there are not very many participants here today, and especially some of those who had registered who are also artists, but maybe we can take this occasion since you're talking about certification and this is getting recorded. Could you also share the kind of certification that you could help with through BUNIC?
Through BUNIC, I think it might be a little difficult because we haven't given a certification yet. We have had two, three interns, and we give like a certificate of like a work experience certificate, a certificate of appreciation that this intern did really good work. But that is when someone actually works for us. And if you are interested in working,
maybe I'm making a mistake in my question. I think you had mentioned that there is an upskilling certificate that you could help with for artists who don't have any certification. So this is something you had mentioned previously.
Upskilling certificate. We haven't received a nod from the organization yet.
Okay.
So I cannot promise that. Right. But I have reached out to Upgrad and I was just checking with them if they would be happy to sponsor some certifications. Right. Well, not art related. They are. So you can just log on to Upgrad and find a course that would be relevant to you. And hopefully they will waive off the fee for LGBTQ candidates who come through Varta. Mm-hmm. It's not final yet, but we are still talking. I hope that does work out, but let's see.
I hope it does.
Mm-hmm.
It will be immensely useful.
Yes. And Upgrad has a lot of courses on anything. Anything on the world that you want to study about, it will have a course there. So let's see if we get free certifications. We would be happy to, like, if you are really passionate about something, I would be happy to talk to you about, like, your passion, about how passionate you are about that particular skill that you want to learn. And we can pay for, if Upgrad is not sponsoring it, Munich will be happy to pay for that certification. But there will be obviously some limitations. It can't be like a certificate course for 5 lakh rupees. We are also still very small and we cannot afford that. But if they are affordable small courses, like an MS Excel course, we can buy one course and we can make sure that 3-4 people share it and learn together. That is something we can work on, but we have not finalized any of that yet. So I won't promise that now. But definitely soon.
All good things begin small.
Yes. So, yeah. It will get bigger soon. Really, really soon. What is the age limit to get chance to get a new job from LinkedIn? Sometimes an old age queer people told me that they're not getting any chance and they are thinking that freshers are getting chances easily then. I would say that, yeah, a lot of companies are preferring that they hire more younger people who are from this current generation, who have this young blood and really want to work, are okay working for like 15 hours a day. And it's kind of like these organizations are trying to exploit young people by making them work extra hard. It's horrible, but old people also aren't getting jobs. It's not that, there is a preference for younger people because companies feel that younger people might just be able to stretch more. They don't have limitations. So it is true that companies are preferring younger people, but it's not that there are no jobs for older people. There are organizations looking for someone with 15 years of experience. So yeah, and LinkedIn, what I see is a lot of young people only posting on LinkedIn. So I want, like, LinkedIn is a platform which everyone should use, no matter what the age is. So everyone should be active there. So if you are like slightly older and are not using LinkedIn a lot, please log in, make a post, talk to people there, make connections. It's a great platform for that.
Ashish,
is that it? I need to get back to my shoot.
Sorry, yes. I've been coming back with too many questions to you. Sorry.
Go ahead.
I just wanted to ask you for your suggestion. Sorry. Is it my connection that is slow because it's lagging for me?
Tell me.
Oh, no. So I was asking you for your suggestion.
No, I can hear you. Go ahead.
In terms of asking people to put their pronouns on their CV?
Yeah, everyone should definitely. It has to be a part. Again, I don't know how did I miss that. Please write your pronouns. It is the best practice to have. I don't know why did I miss that, but it has to be right next to your name. Please feel free to add your pronouns right next to your name on your resume.
All right.
Because that also makes me... I make sure that, okay, that person has mentioned that pronouns, they are aware, they probably know about pronouns, they probably are sensitive towards pronouns of other people also. So it's definitely a best practice to have your pronouns on your resume.
Right, okay.
All right, so if nobody has any other questions, maybe we could wind up by just a mention of how to get in touch with you, Ashish, about one-to-one mentoring. When are you available?
Weekends, I am always free, so you can always reach out to me any weekend. Weekdays, I might not even reply. I am extremely sorry for that. It gets very busy on weekdays. So please feel free to reach out to me on weekends. I am mostly available on weekends. Any Saturday, Sunday, afternoon is the best time. I have my phone number is in the chat. My email ID was in the presentation. You can reach out to me on Instagram, LinkedIn, Facebook, anywhere.
Right.
Just write Ashish Chopra. I hope you find me. I hope there are no more Ashish Chopras out there. Yeah.
Well, so any other thoughts, any questions?
That is...
Arkadipra, she's not here.
I'm right here, but I think I've asked too many. Okay. It's not good.
No, if you have one final question, go for it.
No.
If you have any other announcement or any other thing to share, which I'm forgetting.
I don't think so. Nothing that I can recall at this point.
Right. We will anyways have this recording up within a few days on a YouTube channel and share it with all the participants.
Works.
So let's hope this is useful and helpful for people.
Yes, I hope so too.
Right.
Great. Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone. Happy job hunting.
Yeah. Thank you, Ashish, once again. And this is only, I believe this is only the first session that we've had with you. We will have more.
Many more to come.
To interact. Yeah.
Yeah. Awesome. Looking forward.
All right. So all the best with your shoot. And thank you everyone else. Please send us your suggestions and comments to vartablog@gmail.com or at any other forum where you can find us on Facebook, Telegram, or any other channel.
Perfect. Thank you
so much, everyone.
Thank you so much. Ashish, could we have a word with you once the meeting is over for just a minute?
Works.
Sure. I'll just stay
can
on.
Can you do a phone call? Phone call works?
Yeah, sure.
Awesome. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.